is about the vascular factors in glaucoma and the role of the importance of ocular blood flow in clinical practice. So I'll start with the term called vascular autoregulation of the eye. So what is it? So it is a process by which the body attempts to maintain a stable ocular blood flow despite the changes in the pulse pressure. So the eye tries to maintain that the blood flow to it remains constant all the time, and primarily it is achieved through the metabolic mechanism, which is the concentration of the oxygen and the carbon dioxide, and the myogenic mechanism. The neurogenic and the hormonal pathways play very little role in it. Now what happens is this autoregulation is constantly subjected to challenges like intraocular pressure increase, fluctuating blood pressure, thereby decreasing the ocular perfusion pressure, and or the rise in the tissue metabolic demand. So because of this constant pressure, there is impaired autoregulation or vascular dysregulation which occurs. This causes altered level of oxygen which is supplied to the tissues, and this can cause A, ischemic damage if there is insufficient oxygen, which will lead to the damage to the optic nerve and the RGCs, or B, if there is excess oxygen, it will lead to oxidative damage. So too much or too little, both are bad for the eye. Now we can see clinically some correlation between the vascular factors and glaucoma when we see a disc hemorrhage or a peripapillary atrophy. What we don't see are the roles of aging, systemic hypertension and migraine, but they do have a role. For example, with aging, there are two things which happen. One, the choroidal thickness keeps on decreasing from, let's say, 200 microns at birth to 80 microns at 90 years of age. So there's a constant decrease in the choroidal thickness, and B, the autoregulatory capacity of the eye is decreased. So these two lead to a reduced ocular blood flow. Number two, we don't think about it much, but 47% of the glaucoma patients have hypertension. So hypertension can affect glaucoma in two ways. One, with an increase in the blood pressure, the chronic raised pressure damages the smaller blood vessels. And B, if you're treating these patients with antihypertensives, probably there is some nocturnal hypotension which is going on, and that will reduce the ocular blood flow. So these are the two factors by which hypertension can affect glaucoma patients. And C, 15.6% of the glaucoma patients have migraine. So what's the correlation between the two? Both of these diseases have increased levels of endothelin 1. So endothelin 1 causes two things. One, it causes vasoconstriction of the trabeculum, it causes vasospasm. And two, it causes constriction of the trabecular meshwork, whereby it raises intraocular pressure. So there are these two things, and again, this leads to a reduced ocular blood flow. Now, it's really not possible in our busy clinical settings to measure the ocular perfusion pressure, which is actually the driving force required for the ocular blood flow. So if you try to measure the mean ocular perfusion pressure, it's a bit complex. So let's just look at the two things which we can measure. One is the systolic perfusion pressure, which is the systolic blood pressure minus the IOP. And number two is the diastolic perfusion pressure, which is probably more important, which is the diastolic blood pressure minus the intraocular pressure. So abnormally low ocular perfusion pressure will cause lower ocular blood flow, which will result in optic nerve head and retinal ischemia, as well as reperfusion injury. So this is not something new. The low ocular perfusion pressure being identified as an independent risk factor for glaucoma progression has been there since the consensus series 6, which was way back. Now, what is the evidence for documented reduced perfusion pressure in glaucoma? There's not one, but a number of studies like the Barbados study, the Baltimore, the Egner-Newmark, the early manifest glaucoma trial, the Rotterdam, and all these studies done in different population groups have shown that reduced ocular perfusion pressure is an important risk factor for glaucoma development and or progression. Now, where lies the problem? The problem is, for an individual who is standing up, let's say the mean arterial pressure is 70 and the IOP is 13, has a perfusion pressure of 57. The same person, when he lies down, has a pressure of 84 and an IOP of 15, which gives a perfusion pressure of 69. So there is no really one concrete value. And therefore, even though all these studies point towards the same thing, they cannot specify a number or a figure. We know that there is a 3- to 6-fold increase in glaucoma prevalence if you have a low ocular perfusion pressure. But what is that value? Some studies say it's less than 30 diastolic ocular perfusion pressure. Some studies say it's less than 50. So ocular perfusion pressure being a surrogate or a derived factor is not really concrete. And therefore, we moved on to something called an ocular blood flow, which is more concrete and which we can measure. Now, there are a huge number of instruments to measure ocular blood flow, but color Doppler imaging is probably the one which has emerged as the most important. So what you're seeing is the blood flow inside the ophthalmic artery, the blood flow inside the central retinal artery, and the blood flow in the short posterior ciliary arteries. So for an ophthalmologist, it's really difficult. But if you look at these small blood vessels here, those are the short posterior ciliary arteries. Number two is the central retinal artery, and this is the ophthalmic artery. I'll just show a small clip. You can see the short posterior ciliary arteries, the central retinal artery, and the ophthalmic artery. So it's something which is difficult for us as ophthalmologists to perceive, but it can be done with the help of a radiologist friend. So what you can get is a tracing which will show you the graph of the ophthalmic artery, the central retinal artery, and the short posterior ciliary arteries, and you get a large number of values. But three values are important. One, the peak systolic velocity. Two, the end diastolic velocity. And number three, the resistive index. Again, there is no normative data. There is nothing as normal. So it's very difficult to quantify what is normal and what is abnormal. Now, if you look at these graphs, this is for a control subject. This is for a patient with POAG, and this is for a patient with NTG. So to an untrained eye, everything looks just the same. However, where's the difference? The difference is just this small shift. So with each pulse, less blood is reaching the eye. And that small amount of reduced blood flow is, on the long run, cause damage to the eye. So out of all these factors, only one factor, the resistive index greater than 0.75, has been associated with the development and progression of glaucoma. So what is the take home from this? That lower ocular perfusion pressure, or particularly diastolic ocular perfusion pressure, is associated with the increased risk of development of glaucoma as well as the progression of glaucoma. The autoregulatory capacity of the eye, along with the BP and IOP, these three together determine what is the actual risk. Therefore, patient may be a hypertensive, but may have good autoregulatory mechanisms, so may not develop glaucoma. And the resistive index of greater than 0.75 is definitely a risk factor for glaucoma. Now you have a lesser invasive procedure, the OCT angio, where you can get the angio analytics around the optic nerve head or around the macula. So what you're looking at are these two plexuses, the superficial vascular complex and the deep vascular complex. The superficial vascular complex measures the blood flow in the nerve fiber layer and the ganglion cell layer, whereas the deep vascular complex measures the blood flow in the inner nuclei and the outer plexiform. For glaucoma, the deep plexuses don't really matter. What matters in glaucoma are, number one, the nerve fiber layer plexus around the optic disc. And number two is, if you're looking at around the macula, the nerve fiber layer plexus and the ganglion cell layer plexus, which constitutes the superficial vascular complex. So probably you're going to come up with these charts and graphs and figures where you'll be able to see the capillary dropout along with the RNFL defect. So this is going to be an aid. So this, along with the RNFL and the GCC and the HFA, will all three together probably help you better analyze glaucoma. So has this affected the treatment? The answer to that is yes, because the consensus series 7, again, that was way back in 2009, the WGA recognized that topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors have repeatedly shown to increase ocular blood flow and enhance the blood flow regulation independent of the hypotensive effect. That's the word which is important. So there have been a number of studies. In fact, the major review shows that 76% of the studies have proved that CAIs increase the ocular blood flow in the retrobulbar vasculature. So probably if you have a patient of NTG where you're suspecting that there's something going on regarding the vasculature, you can go for a carbonic anhydrase inhibitor. Betaxolol has also shown to have some promise. This may seem surprising to some of you, but prostaglandin analogs have also been shown to increase the ocular blood flow. Latanoprost, travoprost, and tafluprost have been proven to increase the ocular blood flow. Bimetoprost, it's a little bit suspect because there are no real studies on it. This was a study done by Dr. Alan Harris, like Shuchanda Mam was talking about him. He has shown that 1 month oral administration of antioxidants, particularly lutein-containing antioxidants, they for a few weeks will increase the ocular blood flow biomarkers within the retinal vascular beds and reduce the diastolic blood pressure compared to placebo. So there are these two things. One, it increases the ocular blood flow biomarkers. Two, it reduces the diastolic blood pressure. So probably putting your glaucoma patients on lutein-containing antioxidants is a good idea. And like I discussed before when I was discussing migraine, endothelin 1 causes increased constriction of the trabecular meshwork, which rises IOP. Number two, it causes vasospasm, which causes migraine and reduced ocular blood flow. So there are these endothelin antagonists which are going to come into the market. So that could probably, you know, deal with both these issues. And of course, surgery, trabeculectomy, by lowering the intraocular pressure, will cause an increase in the ocular perfusion pressure. So what are the take-home messages from this particular talk? If possible, in your clinic, measure the diastolic perfusion pressure, which is the diastolic blood pressure minus the intraocular pressure. And like I said before, less than 50 or less than 30, the values are not concrete, may be significant. You can consider measurement of the ocular blood flow in the ophthalmic artery, the central retinal artery, and the short posterior ciliary arteries with the help of a radiologist friend. You can use OCTA for visualizing the perfusion around the optic disc. And you can consider dorzolamide, PGAs, betaxolol, lutein-containing antioxidants for the treatment of these patients. And surgical intervention may be considered for patients who are progressing in spite of normal intraocular pressure. So if you think that ocular blood flow is going to go away, don't think again, because the first ocular blood flow summit was held recently, 2nd to the 5th of September. So in case you've missed it, you can book your dates for 2020. Thank you. Please, sir.
What happens when you give for 1 month antioxidants, what you said?
Yes.
Is that effect sustained?
No, it's not sustained. That's the problem with citicoline. That's the problem with antioxidants. So probably, like Sagarda was saying, you can give a window period, a drug-free period, and you can, you know, at intervals continue for a long time. Yes.
Yeah, that was exactly my question also. And just we were discussing that we sometimes only read up these literature reviews and start a drug without actually realizing whether they also have some side effects. So that is again a big factor that needs to be considered when we start these drugs.
Right.